Welcome to another episode of the SPE podcast, the place where we share interesting stories of interesting people. My name is Louis Morgner, and today I'm joined by Professor Dr. Pete Eichholz.
Yes.
Who is a professor for real estate and finance here at Mass University Business School of Business and Economics. And today we'll talk about many different things. Pete has quite an interesting background and quite a few interesting things he has been up to. And today we'll want to chat about what it means to be an effective person, not only an effective researcher, an entrepreneur, a few different things we dive into. So firstly, thank you very much, Pete, for being here today.
Yeah, Luis, thank you for having me. I'm very excited to be here. And I hope we're going to have a useful and interesting conversation.
I'm sure we will. Let's get right into it.
Yeah.
So when I prepared for this interview or for this podcast episode, I had a look at your CV. And it seemed to never end. It was very long, very detailed, many things.
Yeah.
Where do we start in your professional career?
Well, you know, these academic CVs, they always, they are, let's say, complete. So every publication is on there, every committee you've served in, so you shouldn't be too, you know, overwhelmed by the many pages of it. But yeah, so it's a lifelong of publications and doing stuff, so that adds up to a long CV. But I think if you look at it, then you'll see that it's a two-pronged thing. It's on the one hand an academic career, which is I think my most important career, and that's what I feel most to be, an academic. But besides that, I've also done a lot of entrepreneurial things and set up a couple of businesses, but I've also served on boards of companies and advisory boards of investors and stuff like that. Let's talk about all of that.
Yeah, I think a lot of room for things to discuss. Let's start also with Maastricht. As I learned earlier, you're not originally from Maastricht.
No, no.
How did you end up here?
Well, I had to do civil service instead of military service, and you could do that at at any non-profit organization. So I thought a university was nice. I was studying in Amsterdam at the time. I had my last oral exam. Talked about it with the professor there, and he said, "Well, why don't you come work for me?" And then I said, yeah, I've been in Amsterdam for 6 years. I know it now. I want something else. I said, well, in Maastricht, they're starting a new university. It's just 2 years old. Very new and entrepreneurial, young spirit. Very young, new professor is in finance sitting there. Why don't you call him? And that was Christian Wolf. He was 29 at the time, the youngest professor in the Netherlands. And he came from Chicago. And so I called him, and we hit it off very well. And he said, well, yeah, why don't you come to Maastricht? You'll do your civil service here. So I started doing that. And then, when I was doing that, I was teaching. I was doing some research as a research assistant for him. And then he said, well, I think you have the talent to become an academic, to do a PhD. I'm going to create a PhD position for you, and why don't you do a PhD? So thought a bit about it, and I thought, well, good idea. So it was not a plan. I didn't have a 5-year plan, a 10-year plan. I had no plan at all. And then so I rolled into it, and I loved it, just doing the research, the freedom of it, the ability to satisfy your curiosity. And he invited some folks he knew from Chicago and from the United States academic world to Maastricht to set up a PhD program, an education program, because we were with a couple of PhDs from Maastricht and from Rotterdam. And so I met them too, and they also became mentors, and it was just one big learning experience. It was fantastic. So that was, about 30 years ago. So it was great.
Very cool to see that you are essentially part of this university from very early on, and could also see how this developed over the last few years.
Yeah, yeah.
You mentioned that you're really fascinated about being a researcher and an academic, of course, and letting your curiosity strive and to learn new things.
Yeah.
What is your most interest in that area? Is there something like that specifically, speaks to you?
Now, you see that that it evolves. So when I started out, So if you're an academic, you have to find a topic that is interesting for yourself, but that is also interesting for the academic community, because otherwise you're doing something and everybody says, okay, we already know that, or we don't find it interesting. So you have to find a balance there. And the first topic I worked on was real estate portfolio management, international real estate investment, because there was no research on it. And I saw it was a market niche. It wasn't just not me. Also, my mentor said, this is a market niche. You can become the leading real estate academic in Europe if you dive into that niche. So I did, and I found it fascinating. But it was about international real estate investment. And then through international real estate investment and diversification, I also started looking more at long-term, because I looked at pension fund investment. Pension funds have a very long time horizon. The data that we had was just 20, 30 years. The time horizon of a pension fund is 40 or 50 years. Wasn't long enough. Started doing historic research. So that became then a branch. Then 15 years ago, we started thinking about corporate governance in real estate and in these investments and sustainability and energy efficiency. So I started doing that. And now I do energy efficiency. And then we said, well, you know, that's one aspect of sustainability. Now let's also talk about other aspects of sustainability, like water efficiency or healthy indoor climate in buildings. So now I do that. So you see, your curiosity isn't attached to one topic. You let it roam freely. And if you're lucky, then your curiosity is in line with what is important for society and for science. And then what you find interesting to explore, others find interesting too. And then you can publish it and, you know, become famous about it. So that's what I did. Yeah. So I just followed the path of my own curiosity without... So currently my research, I'm a finance professor, and I do research in the effect of indoor climate on people's health. What does that have to do with finance? Nothing. But it doesn't matter because it's fun to do and it's cool. So, yeah.
Very cool. Also impressive that you can just let your curiosity drive your actions in your life and not to be too determined about what you really want to do later on. One thing I just wondered, when you mentioned that there was kind of a niche that you could get into, there was not that much research yet. I think that plays quite hand in hand with identifying opportunities as
Absolutely.
An entrepreneur
yeah.
as well. So I would say one skill that you kind of demonstrated then is to be good at identifying opportunities.
Yeah.
Nowadays, we are in a time where I think there's a really broad set of knowledge. We have the saying, standing on the shoulder of giants. How would you go about today, about identifying opportunities, whether it's in academia or even entrepreneurship in general?
Well, I guess still the same. So to define it, you have to be perceptive. You have to listen to what is there, what is not there. So when I started out and I knew that... I talked to pension funds. I was also part-time employed at ABP, it's the biggest Dutch pension fund, one of the biggest in Europe. And they were just about to start investing and looking at international investment. And then so I just looked around and I saw there's just no research there. But if ABP starts to invest internationally, then others will so do. Others will do the same because that's a market leader. So then it's not so difficult to predict that this will be an important topic. And nobody's doing it. So, you know, let me do it. And that is what I then devoted a lot of time in my PhD thesis on. And while I was doing that, I saw that not even was there no research, there was also no good data. So it was very difficult to do good empirical analysis on it. But it was also very difficult to do good performance measurement. And pension funds, if they invest in whatever, they need to do performance measurement to determine what they do is the right thing, to determine the bonus of the portfolio managers and whatnot. But there was no performance measurement. So that was not an academic problem, but a practical problem. So I thought, you know, if it's not there, I can wait for somebody to make it. I can also do it myself. So then we set up our first, together with a colleague, our first firm, Global Property Research, and that firm, it really came out of my PhD dissertation, and that firm started making performance indices of listed real estate companies because it didn't exist. And before you knew it, we had subscribers, JP Morgan, Goldman Sachs, Stanford Bernstein, Morgan Stanley, all these names. And they paid subscription fees to us, and we were very happy. So and that's how the first business came about. Same thing. So you go out, and you listen, and you say, hey, you know, this is a need. This is going to happen because the market leader needs it, and it's not there, so others will follow. And so it's actually not so difficult, but you need to listen. Yeah.
I think a good takeaway for anyone also looking into opportunities to eventually exploit. Listening is the first step, indeed.
Yeah.
You already mentioned the first company that you founded. There's quite an extensive background, I would say, because you founded several companies.
Yeah.
Can you walk us through this a little bit? Like, how was your process on the entrepreneurial side of your career?
Yeah, so early on, I decided that academia would be my most, you know, most important, would be the most important aspects of my career, because that's what I really felt most like. But it wasn't going to be the sole aspect of my career, because with academia, you have the problem of irrelevance. And so we do all this research, and basically we tell the world, look, this is my research, this is what comes out, so this is what you should do optimally. And then the world doesn't do it, because nobody says that they need to use my research, and very often they don't. And in the beginning, that's okay, but at some point it becomes annoying. And so this irrelevance problem, many academics probably won't mind, but I do mind. And so I decided that I also wanted to do business stuff, because there, your client actually pays for the stuff and then they use it, right? So there you are relevant automatically because you have this client-producer relationship. So that's why I decided to also do other stuff beside my academic career. Limited my academic career to 3 days a week. So I've never been more at this university. Even when I was head of department for 9 years, I was still just 3 days a week. And the other 2 days a week, I do this entrepreneurial stuff. Okay, so the first company came, that was Global Property Research. And like I said, that came out of my dissertation. That was partly consultancy, partly a publisher of financial data, specialized in listed real estate. That was taken over by a bank, Kempen & Co. That's a small Dutch merchant bank in Amsterdam. So the company also moved to Amsterdam. I went with the company for a couple of years, but then I decided that working for a bank wasn't my thing. Although it's great, but not for me. And at the same time, I set up with a couple of friends. This was when the internet first became big. We set up a firm called M2Match, which was a marketplace for commercial real estate, to rent, and not buying, but for commercial real estate space to rent. And that looked very promising. We had incredibly talented team. We had great outside financing, because this was the first dot-com bubble when outside financing, you know, was easy to get, or relatively easy to get. So it looked really great. We had the great players on our side, but in the end, it didn't work, partly because the existing interests in the commercial real estate market, the brokers, they had too much to lose, and they, you know, logically fought this initiative, and they fought it successfully. So we got killed. So we didn't go bankrupt, but after I think we tried for 2.5 years, 2 capital rounds, and we decided that we're not gonna win this thing. So together with the investors, we decided to liquidate it. And so that was finished. Then about the time that we liquidated that, and I had sold GPR, so I had my hands free, then together with the same friend, I set up GPR. We set up a new company called Finance Ideas. That still exists. That's a consultancy company, so that's now in its 18th year. And we're located in Utrecht, and we employ about 30, 40 people or something. And it's aimed at financing of hospitals and social housing. And we look at pension fund real estate investment, and we advise pension funds. So that's number three. Then about 10 years ago, I set up together with another university colleague, a company called GRESB, And that came out of our research on real estate sustainability. And GRESB is an acronym standing for the Global Real Estate Sustainability Benchmark. That came out of the university again. We did that for a couple of years. Sold it again to, this we sold to Green Building Council International. It's a U.S. green building sort of firm. And the fifth company was called Examen Voor Jou, which was a company helping high school students with preparation for their exam. And after a couple of years, we didn't actually lose money. We actually made money every year, but it was so little money that we decided that it was not worth the effort. So we liquidated that too last year. So five companies, three successes, two failures. But no bankruptcy. That's good.
Well, that's a good starting point. Yeah. I think quite impressive, the different things you did throughout your life. What kind of strikes me is that you were able to transfer your abilities in different contexts, to be curious, to turn ideas into actions, into different contexts and just execute over and over again.
Yeah.
I think there are a few things people could learn from you, especially the ability and your traits, how you approach those projects, how you approach execution in general.
Yeah.
And my first point I would like to talk about is when people struggle to go from idea to execution.
Yeah.
Because they are scared, they're afraid, they're not sure if they could make it.
Yeah.
They're not confident in their abilities, whatever it may be. How do you go about making that jump, or what would you advise other people that are in a similar position to do?
Now, that's a good question. So I first think that you should not overestimate risk. And so people think that entrepreneurship is very risky and that, you know, if it fails, bad for your reputation and you've got waste of time and blah, blah, blah. But it's not risky at all. So most of the companies that I set up, I didn't put in serious amounts of money. Some money, but not my whole. I didn't have to mortgage my house to put it to get the money. You know, we had good ideas. We tried to find outside capital if needed. But even better, for the most of the companies, we didn't even have outside capital. We just had a couple of starting clients. So basically what we did, we said, okay, this is what we're going to do. We're going to look for a couple of founder clients, as it were. We give them special treatment, and with the money that they provide, maybe they have to pay already for 2 or 3 years in advance. They believe in it, and with these starting clients, we can set up the business. And that means that your risk is very, very limited, because there is really no capital. You have turnover basically from day one. And the same thing we did with the consultancy firm. We made a profit from the first quarter onward. So there's And you can predict it, because you can see, okay, you know, we start with a sort of portfolio of clients and projects that we have, and we're going to have that sort of turnover from it. So we're going to be pretty sure that in the first year, this is the kind of turnover we're going to make, so then we can hire these and these people. And so that's the first thing. Don't overestimate risk and think, this is too risky, and I'm going to get a job even if I'm more happy if I'm an entrepreneur. Even if you fail, it still looks good to your CV. It doesn't matter. So especially for students who just finished, like you, you're about to finish your study, don't think, I'm going to not do this because maybe later I'm going to have a mortgage and then I can't get the mortgage. This is the best moment, because you have no kids, no spouse, no mortgage, no house, no sailing yacht, no nothing. You have unlimited freedom to do what you want to do. So that's the first thing. Second thing, and that I've already always done, I've always tried to do this with really good people. And so, and I've made sure that these people get a very big share of the company. So I know some entrepreneurs who say, well, I'm going to be 100% shareholders and I'm going to hire people, et cetera, et cetera. And I know some really good entrepreneurs who are very successful that way. Great. But my approach has always been to do it together with friends, really. Because first, that's more fun. Because I don't like to be alone in this, you know, in the corporate suite, and everybody is afraid of me because I'm the boss and they, you know, they're not honest. It's better to do it with people you really like at the same level. And really good people have really good ideas, and that makes you more successful. But then you have to be willing to share. And so, and my idea has always been, it's better to make the pizza grow very fast than be nitpicking about who gets 20% and who gets 25%. So I'm always very willing to share and give other people's share in the company. It's not a problem as long as it pays out in terms of growth and success. And so that's better for your quality of life. And to be honest, if you work 3 days a week at the university, you have just 2 days left. So the hard reality is that, and you have your weekend too, and I like my weekends. So the hard reality is that you cannot be the sole entrepreneur because you just don't have the time. You need to find other people who say, okay, I'm going to take a stake in this company and I'm going to work full time because otherwise, you know, this doesn't work. So I work 1 day a week for the consultancy firm, but and my the friend I set it up with also, but everybody else works full time, of course. And they get a salary and stuff. I mean, it's not out of their good hearts, but so that's very important. Otherwise, you can't be and an academic and an entrepreneur. You have to share. But so if you're willing to do that, then great, fine. But that does mean you don't want to look in other people's wallet. And so you have to. If other people get rich because of your great idea, that's a consequence, and you have to be able to live with that. But that's fine. There's no problem. So. So I guess that's the most, these are the most important lessons, I think. Yeah.
What I wonder right now is you seem to be a really effective person in everything you touch, not only in academia, but also as an entrepreneur, because you're really open, hands-on mindset. You mentioned a few things that are really important. Firstly, the relationship to uncertainty, and then also the people you choose to work with. My question is, how do you work? Essentially, do you work all day, every day? Do you have a certain way to approach your work in general? What does a typical work day for Pete Eichholz look like?
Well, first, I don't think I really work very hard. So so sometimes I work very hard, but most of the time I don't work very hard. So even when I was a PhD student, I tried never to work in the weekend, and I tried to avoid working in the evenings. And that you can do it. It's possible if you're during the day very efficient. You don't need to put in 60 hours or 70 hours or 80 hours. Many PhD students in our department, they think that if they don't put in 60 hours a week or fix 65 or 70, they're not going to be successful. But I think that's crap. You gotta if you take more time to read books and to read magazines and to discuss with people, then your ideas will be better, and then it's far easier to solve problems in the 40 hours that you give yourself for your work, and then you make the right decisions where it counts. But if you're always tired and stressed because you work so hard, then you're making the wrong decisions, you can't solve the problems, everything comes more time-consuming, and I think that's sort of a dead end. And I've seen, you know, I've worked with PhD students who were very hardworking and very successful, but I always tell them it's not really necessary. You know, it's possible to be a successful academic and a five-time entrepreneur and still not work more than 48 hours a week or 40 hours a week. And if the weather is good, like today, then I'm going to, you know, get on my bike and do some mountain biking. You know, and then I feel totally great about it. I don't put it on Strava because then too many people can see that I'm actually during the week enjoying myself. Eh? That's not good for labor morale. But, you know, I think hard work is great. My dad used to work his ass off really every evening, you know. But what did it bring him? I saw him working every evening until like midnight. And he was successful. But I thought, gee, is this the way to make a living? No. So that's one. You have to be very efficient in the time that you work, but you don't want to work too many hours. That's one thing. Very important. Other thing, what is at least that's my experience, is to also be a generalist. And so I read a lot. And so I read more than most people I know. I read, and mostly books. I don't read a lot of magazines, don't read a lot of newspapers. The stuff that I read, I make sure that it's balanced. So I read The Guardian on the left side and The Economist on the right side, sort of. Not the extremes, of course, but that sort of balanced in that way. So you get also the counter arguments in your news feed. I don't do sort of, let's say, reading on internet, so where the internet provider determines what you read, that you have to avoid at all costs. You have to decide what you read yourself. But on the whole, reading the news is mostly a waste of time, and because the news, it happens, and the next day there's other news, and then there's other news and other news, and you forget what is in the news. It is far better to read books. And so I read a lot of books, and by becoming a generalist, you get better ideas, and you listen something here, and you hear something there, and you read something there, and you combine it, and it's a great idea, and you can execute it in your company or in your work or whatever. So I think that's very important, and I think students right now don't read enough. They read more Twitter than serious stuff. So I think students should read far more than they do now. And it's a pity that they don't. What else? So be effective while you work, but don't work too much. Take your time off. And very importantly, during your time off, feel good about it. So I know so many students, they take a weekend off, but then they really feel guilty that they took a weekend off because they really should be working on this or that. If you're off, you're off, right? And then feel good about it, and then and enjoy it. So what else is there? Yeah, I think that's about it. There is no secret, really.
Mm. Well, I couldn't agree more with the things you said. Yeah. That's one quick thing, which is probably hard to do, but what is the best book you have read? I'm sure there are many in different areas, but if there's one book you would recommend to anyone, like that anyone should read in the world, essentially, which book would that be and why?
Hmm. That's so difficult.
So sorry.
Yeah. Given the audience that is going to listen to this podcast, I would say read the book called Range by David Epstein. And that book is about the importance of being a generalist. And so there are a lot of books who say it's very important to be a specialist, to specialize early on, the 10,000-hour rule, where you have to put in a lot of hours, otherwise you don't become successful. And that holds for musicians, maybe for sports people, but probably not for the rest of us. And this book, Range, makes a very convincing argument of the contrary. He says you have to be a generalist. And why do you have to be a generalist? Well, in any normal professional life, you're going to have a career, but that career is basically, the analog is where you say, well, you're going to encounter a lot of doors. And to go to the next level in your career, you have to go through that door. Well, first you have to discover that the door is even there. Right? So there you need mentors and stuff who say, well, the door is there. But once you know the door, you have to go through it. So you need a key to unlock it. And if you have just one key, because you're very specialized, then you can unlock only one type of door. But there's going to be many more doors and many different doors. So what you need is a whole set of keys. And if you become a generalist, then you have a whole set of keys. You can unlock many doors and you can explore a lot of stuff. And that's the main lesson of that book. And I think that's a message especially important for the current generation of students who tend to think, in my experience, that they need a 5-year plan, a 10-year plan, need to know where they're going to be when they're 32, 35, need to think, I need to make the right choice when I'm 19 and then stick to it, otherwise bad to my, for my CV. And what this book Range says, no, you don't need to do that. It's good to test this, to try that, to explore this, and then gradually you'll find your path. And it's probably going to be a winding path instead of a straight path. And I think, so I very much enjoyed that book, and I think it's a book for this generation. So that's why that would be my advice.
Well, I guess I need to do some reading up and get that book, but I think...
And after the podcast, I can give you 10 more books.
Okay, well, I'll hold you accountable to that one. Another thing that I just thought about when you also mentioned earlier your entrepreneurial steps and also essentially some failures, even though, how do you define a failure? But still, I think failure is an incremental part of also learning and also, building businesses. How do you approach failure? How do you deal with failure?
Well, first by accepting it as inevitable. So many things fail. And even in the businesses that are successful, along the way, there have been many failures. So with GPR, with GRESP, with Finance Ideas, the consultancy company, probably most things we tried failed. But then the ones that do not fail, you move into with all force. So what's important is to accept that there is failure, to diagnose it as early as possible, and then to take another direction, and not to spend good money after bad money. And there's a sunk cost fallacy. We've been spending so much time on this. Let's try it, but it's a failure. So you have to accept that something failed early on and move on to something else, even though if it's not a total failure. And many things are not total failures in the sense that you make huge losses on it or nobody wants it. Quite a few things seem pretty okay because you don't make a loss on it. It sort of goes okay-ish, and then it's very hard to say goodbye. But it would be far better to spend your time on something else that is really successful. And so there it's most difficult to say goodbye to. But you have to do it because otherwise you're spending your time on useless stuff, and you have to spend your time on something else. So I think that's important. So cut your losses, really. And yeah, I think that's the most important thing. But failure is not a problem at all. It's just how it is. Oh yeah, and one last thing. You have to, if you do a business, you have to design it in such a way that you can actually move away from failure. And so I think the big lesson of our last firm, Examen voor Jou, is that we were not able to do that. We had a business model, but Examen voor Jou was essentially an internet company. It was basically videos to help students prepare for their national exam. But since we didn't have the IT folks in-house and we were relying on external IT providers, it was too expensive to every day adjust the site and say, okay, this doesn't work, we try something else, which is the essence of an internet firm, that you can experiment. That we couldn't do. And that's why, because I think in the end it could have been saved by moving to a radically different business model, but we couldn't because we didn't have the organization right. And that, I think, if you start out with something, it's very important to realize what is the essence of the company, what essential skills do you need in-house to make that successful, and then go. And that we didn't do right. So that's why it failed.
You mentioned cutting your losses and not falling victim to the sunk cost fallacy, in a sense. How do you draw the line, though? Because I imagine a business in the beginning needs some time and some believing in yourself and in your vision for something. Where do you draw the line?
Well, so usually you go and pursue things for too long. And so that's almost always the case. So with Examen voor Jou, we should have stopped it 2 years ago or something, but... So we had an extra client, and this is okay. So that's difficult. But if it's part of an ongoing business, then you can actually design a procedure for it. So within Finance Ideas, my consultancy company, we say, okay, we stop something every year. Every year, during the sort of strategy meetings at the end of the year, we decide, okay, what is the project that we're going to stop this year? And then we're just going to say, okay, well, what's the least successful project? And we're going to stop it. So that's a golden rule. Only if the least successful project is still very successful, we're not going to do this. But normally, we have to stop something every year so that we avoid, you know, falling in love with our own babies. And also that the person who is actually behind that particular baby is not insulted. Because we have to stop something every year. Sometimes it's my turn, sometimes it's your turn, no problem. So I think that sort of rule works very well.
Thank you very much for sharing. One last thing I would like to talk with you about is essentially some advice you would give your younger self. I mean, there were a few lessons you mentioned already in the different areas, but what is the one piece of advice or even multiple things that you would mention to your younger self if you had a chance?
Younger self, instead of what should I have done differently or not even?
In retrospect, even what would you have done differently, but also what would you keep doing in retrospect, right? What has proved to be very successful and good for your life?
Yeah. Well, what I did at some point in my career is that I did too much. So around 2000, 2001, I had a professorship here in Maastricht. I had a professorship at the University of Amsterdam. I was still involved with global property research because we had sold it to a bank. I worked for the bank. And we had set up M2Match. So four things. And it was so much that I was unproductive on all of them. And so at some point, your curiosity and your enthusiasm gets you in all these things, but there's only so much you can do. And at that time, I didn't work 40 hours a week. I worked 70 hours a week. And I also saw that that's not an effective way to work. So I had the feeling continuously that I was sort of behind the facts and that I didn't... I couldn't keep up, and that I wasn't actually producing anything useful, and that was just because I tried to do too much. So I think what's important is to focus and to say, okay, you know, this is as much as I can do, and I'm going to do it really well, and that's it. And so that I think that's where it almost went wrong, as it were. But it didn't go wrong. It was fine. But that was the least successful episode because this was too much. Yeah.
So pick wisely what to work on.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Well, Pete, I think that wraps our conversation up quite nicely. Is there one last thing you would like to just say to the audience? You would like to share?
No, thanks very much, and do whatever you like. So don't worry too much about your CV or something like that. Maybe one last thing,
sure.
If the listeners are mostly students, is you probably learn more from a crazy student job than from an internship. For example, my feeling is that I learned most when I was working in the steel factories in IJmuiden, that's in the west of the Netherlands, a bit the Kroep of the Netherlands. I learned more there than in any internship I later did. So also in terms of what you're going to do besides your study, basically use your imagination and do something else than the others do.
Well, very good, I think, for any student listening. So again, Pete, thank you very much for taking the time. For the other people listening right now, feel free to come back for the next episode that we will record shortly. And yeah, overall, I think it was a great conversation. A lot of takeaways and lessons learned for probably anyone, not only me. And again, Pete, thanks a lot for taking the time.
Thanks, Luis.